Here's the Prime Minister.
Today's briefing with Question Time upon us this afternoon. I don't intend for this to be a particularly long press conference compared to ones we've previously had, so just to flag that at the start, apologies to those who have broken into their midday movie. For today's media conference, following another very constructive meeting of the National Cabinet today. Many issues on the table today, and I welcome, of course, the Chief Medical Officer, Professor Brendan Murphy, to this press conference again this afternoon. We received an economic briefing from Dr. Kennedy, which is becoming a standing item now at our regular meetings of the National Cabinet. He was able to take us through the work that he's been briefing federal government on in terms of the impact on the economy, particularly on issues around unemployment and affected sectors, and that's been very helpful as the National Cabinet has continued to consider issues of restrictions and planning for the road ahead. The National Cabinet, as you know, when I presented following the decision to abandon and abolish COAG and to establish the National Cabinet and the National Federation Reform Council, I noted there would be a series of National Cabinet subcommittees that would be established to drive a national jobs agenda, to drive a national agenda to generate jobs. As we look forward over the next 12 months and beyond, our efforts policy level at a federal and state level have to be about creating jobs. And we confirmed six national cabinet subcommittees that will be established, which will be driven by the leaders at national cabinet, and to set out the tasking for those subcommittees on rural and regional skills, infrastructure and transport, population and migration, energy and health. And the leaders that sit around the National Cabinet table are very keen to set very clear expectations and tasking to those National Cabinet subcommittees to ensure they progress a very rapid jobs agenda. In addition to that, the Council of Federal Financial Relations, which is the meeting of state treasurers together with the federal treasurer, which is chaired by Minister Frydenberg, has also been tasked, as we flagged, to do work that will report at the end of August on consolidating and rationalising the national partnership agreements. And in addition to that, they will take forward the issues on tax reform and on deregulation. Also today, I provided an update to all Premiers and Chief Ministers on our progress on closing the gap, and pleased to report that on that front that we're making excellent progress when it comes to the Closing the Gap initiative and the new targets that will be established, and we anticipate that they'll be in place next month. And that work has of course involved the Council of Indigenous Peaks, and they will be considering those new goals over the course of this month, as will the Federal Cabinet, and states and territories will also be involved in that process, and we would hope that they would all be agreed next month. And that's great work that is taking place there. This is the first time that the Closing the Gap targets will have been set with Indigenous Australians, not for Indigenous Australians, which is a significant change. Also today, we reaffirmed our commitment to the three-step process to ensure that we are on track for concluding the third step of that three-step process in July. On top of that, we also confirmed that it is the national strategy, which brings together all the states and territories, to pursue a policy of suppression. If we are able to achieve elimination or eradication as a byproduct, then that's well and good. But we are not going to have our policies trapped by the goal of eradication. And it's important to note that there being cases and there being the odd outbreak here or there is something that is anticipated and the system has been built to deal with. But the emergence of cases is not something that will necessarily require the three-step process and the opening up of the economy to be halted, but that will always be subject to the medical advice from the medical expert panel of the AHPPC. We are on track for the three-step process to be completed in July, and today we made some important decisions to change elements of that third step. The first of those is, as you look across the third step, you will note a series of caps for indoor gatherings of 100. And that can be anything from funerals through to the number of people who can be in a premises or even in a room such as this. That 100 cap for step three across all of those areas will be removed, and it will be replaced by a 4 square metre rule application to those premises. So depending on how large your premise is, and that 4 square metre rule applies to each room within that premise. And you'll note that around this building, you'll certainly note it in my office, there's a number of people who are allowed to be in that room at any one time based on the 4 square metre rule. Now that will mean obviously for much larger premises, that will provide much greater scope. Now this is not happening immediately, this is part of step three. So states and territories who are making decisions about when they're moving to that step three, that they will now be moving based on the policy of 4 square metres being applied, and those caps of 100 for a particular building, they won't be in place. It'll be determined on that basis. 4 square metre rule by room. Now the 4 square metre rule continues to be reviewed by the AHPPC, the medical expert panel, and further work has been done on that, particularly for much smaller premises. Also, for outdoor events, for outdoor organised events, sporting, cultural, we will be moving as part of step three for events in stadia or other venues of that nature with a capacity of 40,000 or less to enable attendance at those events which are ticketed and are seated, all the social distancing rules apply, for up to 25% of the capacity of those venues to take patrons. Now, there will be further work done over the next fortnight. This is not something that's happening straight away. This is something that would be happening as part of step three, where states and territories choose to move to that, and it will require a bit more work, so that's in July, but we have to give venues and others time to prepare for that sort of change. And I think that will be welcomed. Issues that have to be then addressed is access to the wet areas of those stadia, the bars and so on. And I have no doubt there will be some view about restrictions on those because they tend to be the areas where people would congregate and gather, and that obviously presents risk. But when we're talking about people who have bought a ticket, so we know who's bought a ticket, we know where they're seated, then that enables those sorts of gatherings to take place in that structured way. Now that would of course extend to outdoor festivals where they are ticketed and where they are seated. So if we're talking about sort of large folk festivals where people sort of roam around from tent to tent and gathering to gathering, that is not something that is being talked about here. It would have to be a large open area. There would need to be seats at the appropriate distance. It would need to be ticketed, and so people would be able to understand who is in attendance at that event. It's important to note that for venues greater than 40,000, that is an entirely separate issue. And that will require further work because it's not just the number of people who are in the venue. When you're up above 40,000, you've got more than 10,000 people going to a gathering, that it has implications for the egress and access off to those premises, public transport crushes, all of those sorts of things. And that will require much more significant work, and I know that's work that both the medical expert panel and the states and territories who have those larger venues are keen to work on, but I wouldn't want to raise expectations there. I think that will require a fair bit of work. But for those smaller sort of mid-tier venues and below, up to 25% is something that can be done in step three, and so venues and state and territories can now move to plan around that together with sporting codes and cultural performances and organisers, and I'm sure that will be very welcome. Now, when I noted, the 100 person cap on indoor being removed and replaced by the 4 square metre rule, that includes funerals. It also includes funerals for outdoor areas as well. So this is, an issue that has caused great heartache across the community, and I think we've all shared that, and I think that will be a very welcome change. So if they're larger venues, then obviously they can have larger attendances. And if they're outdoor venues, then obviously properly seated and properly arranged, they'll be able to accommodate larger gatherings. And I'm sure everyone will be looking forward to that. That also applies to places of worship, of course, and things like that, depending on the size of the venue and how they're arranged. And I'm sure people are looking forward to that. I know I am. Now, in terms of nightclubs, also, that is not on the agenda. We have seen overseas that has been one of the areas of failure when nightclubs have opened. And Michael Gunner, the Chief Minister in the Northern Territory today, noted that even though that is not prohibited, the application of the 1.5 metre distancing means that venues have not opened there, because it's just not commercially practical to do so. And so I wouldn't anticipate those venues opening anytime soon, or as I said, those larger mass gathering festivals and events that take place. Finally, on international students. On international students, we'll be working closely with states and territories, firstly on a pilot basis, and to enable in a very controlled setting for international students to be able to come to Australia, but only on pre-approved plans for particular institutions worked up between federal authorities and state and territory authorities. I'm not suggesting this is going to happen soon. There's still a lot of work to do that needs to get in place. We have received some very, well thought through proposals from states as to how this can be done, particularly here in the ACT. And this is something that I'm sure we would all welcome happening again, but it has to be done with the appropriate quarantine, entry arrangements, and biosecurity and all of those matters being addressed. And that's something that I know Border Force is working on. Our federal cabinet has been considering that now for some time, and we're still a little way away before being able to advance on those proposals. But I made one thing very clear to the states and territories today. If you can't come to your state from Sydney, then no one's coming to your state from Singapore. And so if you want borders open for international students, then you need to open borders for Australians. And I welcome the decision, which I understand was made after National Cabinet today by the Queensland Government, to nominate a date for the opening of that border in Queensland. That is welcome. We had a very open discussion about those issues today. The three-step process is very clear. It was a very constructive discussion. I anticipate states will be working through those decisions in the next few weeks, and they'll come to their own conclusions. But what is important, whatever date that is, that it is nominated as soon as possible, because that will enable the travel and tourism and hospitality industry to plan for that time. And so that is a matter for the states. But I welcome the decision in Queensland, and we look forward to other decisions being made soon, and for that, and that to enable those jobs and those businesses to be able to be realised. Finally, and I'll allow the Chief Medical Officer to speak more on this matter, and that is on the rallies and protests that are planned for this weekend. The medical advice hasn't changed. The medical advice is that this is an unsafe thing to do. It puts not only your own health at risk, but it puts other people's lives at risk. It puts the, in an economic terms, because of the potential risk of a wave that can come from these events, it puts the livelihoods of other Australians at risk, people's businesses. It puts the progress that we've been able to make at risk. And the very clear message is that people should not attend those events, because it is against the health advice to do so. And so I would strongly encourage people to exercise that responsibility by not attending those events, and to respect their fellow Australians by exercising that responsibility. And on the views they wish to express, that they seek to express those in another way. This is not about the issue that people are raising. This is about people's health and welfare, and I would urge Australians to respect that by not attending those events. State and territory governments are responsible for law and order in their jurisdictions, and they will be taking the decisions about what is done in relation to those gatherings, but we would simply urge you to do it. I don't believe there should be a double standard. There shouldn't be a double standard when it comes to this. Australians have made great sacrifices to get us to where we are today, and everyone has had very significant personal issues about which they have great feeling. And if they can accommodate that in the actions that they're taking and showing the discipline and respecting the restrictions that have been put in place, then so should everybody else. There should be no two sets of rules in this country when it comes to this. Thank you, Brent.